I got my hush puppies on. I guess I never was meant for glitter rock and roll. And honey, I didn't know that I'd be missing you so. Come Monday, it'll be alright. Come Monday, I'll be holding you tight. I spent four lonely days in a brown hilly haze. And
boom, what's up, Chinch? How we doing, brother?
I'm good, man. Good. Slammed. We're both slammed, man. We run around like crazy. So we have like jobs between us, and we gotta find time for this because this is our favorite thing to do.
I know, dude. How was Thanksgiving, dude? I don't think we've talked since Thanksgiving. I know Jess got her hand in the dogs. Tell us about that.
No, she dropped a piece of food and went to grab it at the same time that Macy, the big one, was trying to grab at it too. And instead of getting the food, it got her thumb, and you saw the scar. Got her.
Oh no, dude! I know.
In the gap there too, so she can't do this. So she's like typing with her. Like, think about if you can't use your thumbs, dude. It's what separates us from the rest, from all the other animals in this world. Not using your thumb is one of the toughest things in the whole world to do. It's been killing her for a week.
But anyway,
on a positive note, we went over, I told you, my dad's, we're selling his house. And so it was the last holiday maybe we were ever going to have there. So it was really nice. It was nice. It was just us, some in-laws, and just chilling out with Amaya, the little niece baby. You saw that. I sent you that video of my niece, Amaya, putting the stuff on a crib.
So cute. And then she almost ate it off the chair. She's like, whoa.
Yeah.
She's like, I almost fell right there. She was so cute, dude. Oh my God. That was, I remember those days, like decorating the trees with the girls and the boys. And oh my God, crazy time flies. When she was like the angel, we don't have the angel on top of the,
that was
the big thing. I used to pick one of the kids up to put the angel on. It was always a huge fight every day. I'm like, all right, we're not going to fight about putting the angel on top. It's ridiculous. You know what I mean? It's incredible.
I can tell you right now that the two people who will have no problem putting the angel on top of a Christmas tree are your two freaking sons, bro. Yes, Janelle's like, oh my God, is that Hans and Franz from Saturday Night Live? They're two of the biggest I've ever seen, dude. And they're jacked. They're both jacked now.
Bro, dude, they're so jacked and so much bigger than me. Jake grew an inch at college. So he went to college at 6'1". He's now 6'2". And then Andrew's 6'5". He's huge. Dude, and all they do is lift and freaking eat. And it's incredible, man. It's incredible to see these kids, how big they're getting. I swear to God, Andrew cooks like five meals a day for himself. Like healthy meals, but like tons of food.
Yeah, dude, they could play like the next Aquaman and Thor in the next Now, wait a minute. Is their mom tall? She's tall, right?
Yeah, Mandy's like, she's like 5'8". She's not super tall. Her dad is a monster.
Oh, really?
Big John Kankin. He listens to this podcast. So, Big John Kankin. I'm not kidding you when I tell you this. No joke. His calves are this big.
No.
Dude, John Kankin's calves look like quads, and he's 6'4". He's played college football, monster of just, dude, he can't put a wristwatch on because it doesn't fit around his wrist. That's how big he is.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
So I'm 6'3", 6'4" in the program, obviously, but 6'3", legit.
In your heart.
And like, you know, my mom's brothers are all tall, but like they do have some tall genes. There's no doubt about it.
Well, that's like, do you know, Harold Reynolds' kids are getting really tall. And, you know, so Harold's wife is 5'10". Kelly, she was like a model for Forge, tall lady. Her brothers are all like 6'7" to 6'9". And her dad.
Oh, what?
I think he said this on our show, right? Wasn't his dad was a big time, or her dad was like a big time football player. All the kids play football and everything. All of Harold's kids play football, brothers and sisters and aunts and uncles. So like his kids are growing, like they're going to be like 7 footers, all of them.
Yeah, dude. Harold's like his one brother's like one of the greatest athletes of all time out in USC or Oregon or something. I can't remember what school with. Like the guy was a killer.
Yeah, and he like helped invented Nike. That family's crazy. They got a lot of good stuff going. I got to call him back. All right, hey, so let's get into some baseball news. We're starting to see some grumblings. It's the holidays over. You said right. So Thanksgiving's over.
Yeah,
you guys are saying I want to get this done before you know Christmas or any holiday you celebrate. Like I want to get this done sooner rather than later. So Verlander, what are we thinking so far?
The winter meetings are coming up next. Winter meetings are coming up next week too, and you know that's where a ton of the action happens. So I think the stage is starting to get set as we come up on the winter meetings at San Diego next week, which I'll be at. I'll be covering the winter meetings for the network, so I'm looking forward to that. Yeah, well, they're like, hey, you want to do the winter meetings? I'm like, where is it? They're like, San Diego. I was like, yeah, I'll do it. Sounds great. Who doesn't want to go to San Diego? You know what I mean?
Do your shows
spend it.
No, you just got to walk. Just walk on the strip, and that's how we'll do the show next week in the mornings.
Seriously, dude.
No, dude.
It's so beautiful.
I love it out there. All right, anyway, so keep going.
Yeah, it's peaceful. It's peaceful. Yeah. So it looks like Verlander's set to meet with the Dodgers this week, that's interesting because, you know, when everyone's talking about where's Verlander going to land, that to me sounds like, you know, Verlander wants to win right now. He wants to win another world championship, and that for me just like sounds like, you know, you're bringing the Cy Young Award winner in, veteran guy, would fit right in with that rotation. I just think that's huge. I think the one thing though, you know, that maybe holds the Dodgers back, you know, there'll always be bitterness there from that 2017 team when I think that's when Verlander came, right? Is that when Verlander came?
Yeah.
And they all, you know, the cheating scandal and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, that anyone that's on the Astros during those teams, you know what I mean? Obviously Verlander was a pitcher, wasn't getting the signs, you know, with the trash can, but I think that would make sense. Let bygones be bygones. If Verlander slides into that rotation, I mean, that's incredible. I don't even know if you could take the Dodgers to another level, but it would still make them one of the best teams out there. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And you know, you always say it like your family has something to do with where you want to live your life and work and all of that. And you know, his wife is a model and an actress. And like, so that's where sometimes the LA, the New York, actually, you know, it doesn't just play with the guy who's getting on a mound. He's got a whole family. He's got, you know, does he have kids? I think he has kids, right? I don't know.
He has kids. Oh yeah. 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 He's got a daughter.
Finish strong.
And his wife's Kate Upton, who's one of the greatest supermodels ever. And she would probably love it out in LA. Yeah. And also it also fits the Dodgers mold of like, obviously on the Trevor Bauer one with that whole mess, but you know, they would love to give Verlander, who's 39 and aging well, something like a Scherzer, like maybe a three-year, $120 million deal, $40 million a year, you know, kind of gets him a couple more. You're going to get a couple good years out of Verlander, and then, you know, you're going to have to pay it a premium to get there. So it makes sense.
Right. And by the way, you're correct. Verlander got traded in 2017 from the Tigers to Houston for that playoff run. So you're absolutely right. That's when he was there.
Yes. He was around.
What does that do? Like, so my question is, you know, you've been through this. Like, are the agents sitting there talking to DeGrom going, chill out, let's see what Verlander does? Or are they going, what do you want for DeGrom? And Rodon, he's the guy who I think can benefit most from sitting on his ass and wait until everybody else.
Let those guys, let Verlander, DeGrom set the market. And then Rodon comes in and goes, hey, here we go.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, and Rodon's had a couple great years, you know, obviously opted out of the Giants contract, but he's, you know, he's got great stuff. And Chris Young down there in Texas, they need pitching and they're going to go for it. They're going to go for pitching. They're going to land one of these guys. There's no doubt about it. They're going to be willing to overpay. And they got the new stadium. You know, they signed Simeon Seager last year. You know, they drafted Jack Leiter, you know, and a couple other, you know, frontline pitchers. So
Kumar wound up, but don't forget, didn't Kumar Rocker?
Yeah, and Rocker, Kumar Rocker. So that's right. That's right. Rocker.
Two pitchers of the last 2 years, two or three years in the draft.
Right.
Why not put a Verlander with them or a DeGrom with them and
Rodon.
Like, let them just sit. I would actually, honest to God, I know, like, I would say halfway through the season, I would get those guys up and have them just sit there and follow like a puppy dog around whoever you sign. I bet the Rangers go for it with at least one of those guys.
Yeah, I think so too. They're going to land somebody because Chris Young's going to overpay. But I think, you know, Verlander or DeGrom setting the market for a guy like Rodon would be, you know, that's huge. Yeah.
So I've read this one random thing, and it was more of like the SMY kind of spin on things, but they said, hey, let's just say you don't get to keep DeGrom if you're the Mets. Somebody made this pitch the other day to say, screw it, and go after Trey Turner and figure out a way, a position for him to play, maybe put him in the outfield. Don't sign Nimmo. Don't sign DeGrom. And then go get Turner. And then you have that lineup becomes a lot more dynamic in the National League. And then you fill the back end with just pretty good pitching. What's your take on that? What's your take on getting an offensive superstar lineup without having the ace pitcher?
Ooh, I don't know, man. I think at the end of the day, we know pitching wins championships. So, like, but dude, do you want Trey Turner on our team? Yeah, you do, of course. And that'd be, dude, in New York, your guy would be a superstar. But I also think, like, you win on the bump, and Chris Bassett, you know, is gone. I think Taiwan Walker's out of that mix too. So you got really just Scherzer sitting there. If you don't bring DeGrom back,
right
now you're kind of piecemealing that rotation. You got Scherzer's a year older. You know, he's been getting banged up a little bit more in these recent years. So, you know, now you could have a problem on your hands if you don't make sure you stack that rotation. Chinch, don't you agree? Nowadays, it seems like every team has to have 10 starters.
You have to.
Like, you know, but even if you, you know, if you have some prospects or some frontline guys, but to get through a Major League Baseball season with the way that they do it nowadays, it seems like you have to have 10 starters, you know, with guys going down and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's the typical thing that every spring training, they're like, oh, who's going to be 5? Who's going to be 6? Who's going to be, you know, who do they have coming up? Guess what? Your 4, 5, 6, and 7 pitchers, I bet, are going to get 8 to 10 starts, all of them,
right?
I think, over the course of their year. I'm just doing that math quick in my head, but, like, there is 2 to 4 weeks where every starting pitcher will go down with something, has to miss a start. They miss that one start, then you skip them for 2 weeks. And then, like, you know, the all-star break, you can work around things. You need – I would get as much pitching as humanly possible. You know what I'm saying?
And I agree. I agree. Yeah. I also read something in here too about, they were talking about how the Dodgers deciding between Judge and Ohtani, because they were saying if they lock up Judge, then Ohtani becomes free at some point, either in a trade or a free agency after this year. Mm-hmm. You can't sign them both.
Right.
So if you're the Dodgers, do you say, hey, man, we got a guy that loves it out in LA. We're a team that's going to win every year. We have the money to pay him. He can take up one roster spot for us and, like, save a roster spot. Do you give the money to a guy like Ohtani, and you sell out when he becomes a free agent, and instead of signing a guy like Judge? You know what I mean?
Great point. Well, here's a point I haven't heard yet. Maybe I'm making this up, or maybe I have heard, but I haven't heard this yet. Ohtani has a little extra weight in the fact that, because when you, okay, I want to go get DeGrom. Well, I don't know. What if he blows out? I want to go get Ohtani. I don't know. What if he blows out? Well, he proved he could blow out and still be maybe your best offensive player.
Hitter.
Right. That's the thing. He already got hurt on the mound, and he already proved that he can still be your 1 through 4 in your lineup on any given day and be one of the most dynamic hitters in the game. And probably be even a little better of a hitter when he's not ever pitching at all. I don't know, man. I don't know. I think if you can say that Shohei Ohtani was in your franchise at one point in your life, you've done a good job as a GM or an ownership group, because he's, like you said, he's a unicorn. You keep calling him a unicorn. Like, I don't know. I would take a ride on him if you could trade for him. But here's the problem, though. Like, the Dodgers, you're gonna have to empty out a farm system for him, right? You're gonna have to empty out.
Yeah, well, I think you wait till he's a free agent.
Yeah,
you wait till after the year until he's a free agent, and you don't give up your farm for him, but you give him he's gonna make $50 million a year, I think.
He has.
So you think if these pitchers are making 40, Ohtani's gonna make 50 something. He's a true unicorn.
He really is. Now, Judge, I love Judge, and he's great, and he's gonna be great for anybody. I just think for Judge and for everybody else and for all of baseball, I just want to see him stay with the Yankees. And that's not even as a Yankee fan. I'm just saying, as like a baseball fan, like, you need that guy. I don't know. I just think if I'm him, if it's not, God, how many million dollars a year more does it take for, no matter what the Yankees do, that Judge says, I have to take that deal. Do you understand what I'm saying? So Let's just say
I think it's like five to six mil more a year. Over 7 years, that's another 40 mil.
Yeah.
It's like you go back to Pujols. Didn't the Cardinals offer Pujols 200 and the Angels offered him 240?
Right.
Same thing with the Yankees offered Cano close to 200 and the Mariners offered 240. It's maybe that $40 million, like $40 million, $40 million. You know what I mean? Like
Now you start talking about great grandchildren and great great grandchildren being
And also too,
at the, just your grandchildren being okay.
Exactly. Everyone's set up. Yeah. But at the end of the day, Chinch, you know, bro, the Yankees can afford it. So if they're going to go $40 million less than the Giants or something like that, see you later.
I think you're right.
I think.
It's a very interesting topic.
Yeah. And you know the Giants or the Dodgers or somebody is going to push the envelope here. They're going to push the Yankees at the brink of, do we keep them or don't we? Because the Yankees, no doubt, even though Hal Steinbrenner is saying what he's saying, Cashman, I just feel like Cash has a number that he's not going to be willing to go over.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they trust him, and you got to trust him. He's one of the best presidents ever of all time. It's really going to be it's going to be a crazy winter meetings. Now, let's do this. You think any of this gets done between today and the end of the winter meetings? Who would be signed? Who will be signed?
Give who me will one. Be signed?
Yeah.
I think you're definitely going to see Rodon signed. And I think you're going to see Verlander signed by the end of the winter meetings. I no doubt about that. I'd also be shocked if you don't see Judge.
Mm.
You know what I mean? I don't know if he wants – I don't know. I do like that he's doing the free agent thing and going to see the Giants, maybe going to see the Dodgers. Sure. Because
he's earned it, first of all.
He's earned it to let the Yankees sweat a little bit. Like, you know what I mean? When he turned down that $213 million deal and then proved that he was the best player on the planet right now. So he's earned the right to kind of go through it. But, you know, I think at some point here, you're gonna have all the offers on the table. You're going to have all the teams involved. And if you're Judge – you know, if you want to enjoy your off season, you know, you're probably going to, you know, the offers will be out there where you're going to make a decision. So.
All right. Yeah, man, it's going to be so interesting. So you're going to be in San Diego. I'm a little jealous of that, but what else are you excited? Or you're starting to do your studying real hard right now. Yeah. What else are you locked in on and excited about seeing possibly happen at the meetings?
I just think this shortstop class is just awesome. And I think that's going to be fun to see, you know, how those dominoes fall. Who's going to be the first one? Because Trey Turner is going to set the market there. Mm-hmm. You got Turner. Is Bogarts going to leave Boston and end up in Philly? You know, you're starting to hear that. Is Turner end up in Philly? Where's Correa land? Where's Dansby Swanson go? Is he in L.A.? I think those, you know, having those four guys out there, you know, it's just kind of fun to watch the market. And then there's other guys too, like a Jose Abreu, you know, Brandon Nimmo, you got Josh Bell out there. So there's some good names, you know, that are floating out there. And there's so many other starting pitchers though, you know, in Syndergaard and Bassett and all these guys that are out there too. So there's a ton of guys. I always love this time of year when you get closer to winter meetings, you start seeing the dominoes fall. It kind of affects everything. Then you start to see it, the ripple effect of it. So I'm looking forward to going to winter meetings to just see how it all plays out.
It's going to be awesome. I'll give you a couple other guys just kind of from that other angle that we haven't talked about in so many years, but like you got Bellinger out there, you know,
yes.
Are you going to gamble on him being what he used to be? You got Michael Brantley out there who was hurt most of last year, but has been one of the best hitters in baseball for the last 10 to 15 years. There's other those guys that you're going to go, oh crap, we got him. I forgot he was out there. So this is going to be an exciting one. I'm excited you're going. Good for you.
Yeah, great, dude. Yeah, it's going to be great. I'm excited you're going too, man.
Give me
what do you want? I'll bring in a winter meeting shirt. Do they have those there? I don't think they sell winter meeting shirts.
I don't think they do. No, they just sell jerseys and stuff. I got a Swiss Army knife from there. It says San Diego, and it's a Swiss Army knife. I just got it because it said San Diego last time I was out there.
Oh, that's cool, dude. Love that's awesome.
Dude, they have the gas lamp district, bro.
Oh, it's so nice. I know. Sarah's going to get a couple meals, though. Get a couple nice meals.
Oh, dude, you're going to be grinding out inside a stuffy hotel for 4 hours talking about Michael Brantley, and Sarah's just going to be surfing. She's going to be swimming with the dolphins. She's going to go on a take a ride on like one of those U-boats out there. Oh, man, she's going to have a blast. I'm
drinking a margarita on the beach. Like, this is wonderful. I love the winter meetings.
Exactly. All right, have fun out there. We're not done. This is the beginning of our week. We're just getting started. We'll keep ramping it up. Keep coming up with more meeting topics. And we'll talk a little football this week. And we got Boo Wednesday. So, and by the way, we got another interview coming, don't we?
Yeah, man, we got my buddy Brian Panuzzo, great dude. Like I said, great story, awesome life coach out there in LA. So we'll be dropping him this week too. It's gonna be great.
Awesome, it's gonna be a good week.
Okay, all right, and if you haven't checked it out, go check out our Brian Kane podcast that we dropped on Friday. So good, one of the best mental performance coaches in the world.
Yes, sir.
Some great stuff he has, and especially with being in George St. Pierre's corner at the height of his reign at the USC. Incredible stuff.
Excited to hear about that. All right, let's do it, man.
Okay. All right, Chichi. Love you, bud. I'll see you tomorrow, man.
All right, see you.
And honey, I didn't know that I'd be missing you so. Come Monday, it'll be all